We have a special treat this evening. Sunil Kilnani to speak on his new book, Incarnations, India and 50 Lives, which is just out and scaling the charts. Sunil, you will know as the author of The Idea of India, which was published almost 20 years back, published in 1997. And it is, of course, one of the most acclaimed and influential books ever written on India. Sunil Kilnani is currently Professor of Politics and Director of the India Institute at King's College, London. And Sunil has a whole presentation on the book, which is also with slides and so on, but just to very quickly tell you why, as publishers, why this book is really important to us. Now, you know, it's a standard complaint in India, that we hear this a lot, that there aren't enough good books on Indian history. We are very strong on myth, we are strong on legend, but somehow when it comes to history, we are a bit lax. Now, Incarnation fills that void, at least partly. This is a deeply researched, brilliantly written book. As you probably know, it accompanies a major BBC Radio 4 series. And what he does in the book is he explores the lives of 50 Indians. And we are, in terms of time range, we are talking about from the Buddha to Dhirubhai Ambani, and from Akbar to Tagore, from Shivaji to M.F. Hussain. And what he shows is how the world's largest democracy, that's called India, actually came to be and why it is the way that it is. It's a book about ideas, it's a book about humanity, and especially for new readers, especially for readers of the new generation, we are celebrating 70 years of India's independence next year. And we are sometimes really, we fail to look back beyond those 70 years and to what really made us who we are. And this book does tell you how we came to be. And I would really say that it's a must read. It's also superbly, those of you who have seen copies of the book are here, available for sale, superbly illustrated. It's a sumptuous work and really a keepsake. So anyway, let me stop hard selling the book to you and let me hand over to Sunil, who has a presentation on the book, and which will be followed by a conversation. But first, over to Sunil.
Thanks so much for that introduction, and thank you all for being here this evening. It's a fantastic venue to be speaking at, and I wish some of the lecture rooms that I have to appear in quite often looked anything like this. Some four decades ago, a violent storm hit Sanathi, a small village on the Bhima River in northern Karnataka. The roof of the temple village, the roof of the village temple collapsed, and the image of the deity, Kalikamba, was crushed. And we inched forward another step in our understanding of the complexity of Indian history. Kalikamba had long stood upon a large stone slab, its center knocked out in order to hold her square pedestal. It's just taking a minute to load, I think. But as the workers cleared away the storm's debris, the slab got flipped over, and on the underside were inscriptions in the Brahmi script, fragments, archaeologists would later determine, of two rock edicts of the 3rd century BC emperor, Ashoka. The subject of one of the buried edicts was, as it happens, the importance of respect for the beliefs of others. Whoever praises his own religion due to excessive devotion and condemns others with the thought, let me glorify my own religion, only harms his own religion, the edict reads. One should listen to and respect the doctrines professed by others. As I reflected upon that edict at Sanathi, I was struck by the historical irony. Ashoka's optimistic words on religious tolerance had been literally turned upside down, cut up and repurposed as a platform for a Hindu goddess. And here was, I think, a vivid instance of the Brahminic power play that had for centuries helped to suppress the thinking of Ashoka, not to mention the man whose teachings influenced him, the Buddha. It was a suppression that lasted until, in the 20th century, freedom fighters, building on the work of the now much denigrated British Orientalists, elevated Ashoka into the very symbol of the modern Indian nation. Tracing that edict's topsy-turvy history, I found myself growing impatient with Jawaharlal Nehru's famous description of the Indian past as a palimpsest, where each successively dominant culture, religion, or group left traces, but never fully effaced what had come before. That's a beautiful image, and it's evocative, I think, of our deep civilizational stratigraphy. And sometimes it's also true. But as I worked on this book, I came to think of that palimpsest image as entirely too passive. For me, the Indian past is an arena of ferocious contest, a space of suppressions, subversions, and historical guerrilla actions, a place where dead heroes regularly spring back to life, dispatched to the front lines of contemporary cultural and political battles. Traveling across the country for my book over these last few years, I kept that notion of struggle close in my mind, along with my own bedrock premise of the project. That at times, and perhaps especially these times, studying the arc of history isn't just a backward-looking indulgence. Rather, it's an active means of pushing us forward towards something greater than we are today. Recently, most of the West has woken up to the fact that India can neither be ignored nor ghettoized as part of the sideshow of developing countries. In the last 70 years since independence and partition, India has become the fastest growing economy on the planet, and perhaps by 2030 we'll also be the most populous nation. As what happens in India matters more and more to the rest of the world, it seems to me well past time for us to set aside the young adult versions of India's history and transformation. Instead, I think we can engage with new and eye-opening scholarship, archaeological discoveries, recently discovered documents, declassified files, and I drew upon all of these sources and many others too to try in my book to give a more grown-up measure of the nation now undergoing this unprecedented and indeed, I think, world historical change. In corporate circles, the simple key to India's transformation is said to be the economic liberalization of 1991. In certain Western quarters, people still argue that the key was imperial generosity, the Raj having given their subjects or set up their subjects with the English language and with some pretty nice trains. But I want to bring into the debate an aspect that we often neglect, and that's the role of remarkable individuals. For that's something that struck me long before I decided to write this book, that although Indian history has dynasties, epochs, castes, religions, communities, it remains, relative to other countries, a curiously unpeopled place. Sure, we have a few historical celebrities, But too often these complicated men and women get turned into effectively venerable wallpaper, mystical and miraculous, but unrecognizable as human beings. And meanwhile, we exclude from the pantheon other individuals whose fascinating journeys from anonymity to achievement would, I think, if properly reconsidered, permit a better understanding of conflicts that still wrench us today. As I try to demythologize Indian history in order to rehumanize it, I want to underline a second intent of mine in this book, which seems relevant, I think, to the struggles unfolding all around us. I'd like to remind readers that what's driven India forward, made it stronger and less oppressive historically, has been the spirit of individual dissent. The rabble-rousers and critics that I write about, often young and, yes, often angry, took on their society and its customs and habits also in brave and, I think, spectacularly imaginative ways, often in very constrained circumstances. And in doing so, I think they contributed more than we sometimes like to acknowledge to the creation of India's contemporary incarnation as a global power. So my book gathers together poets, artists, reformers, kings, mathematicians, a tribal healer, a visionary engineer, among others, some of whose names are still little known. Other names might be famous, but their lives, I think, are in many ways still misunderstood. For instance, in the book, you'll meet the real Vivekananda, the baby-faced, cigar-smoking monk who effectively founded yoga, living in Manhattan, as it happens. And I'll show you how he was a perceptive critic of many aspects of Hinduism and also deeply influenced by American egalitarian practices, although later he gets incarnated as a mascot for the Hindu right. And I think what's true of Vivekananda is true of many of the other men and women I write about. It's only when we turn to their historical times and see the predicaments they were struggling with that we can begin to recognize what really was extraordinary about them. A deeper grasp of Indian history can also help us, I think, to see much more clearly than we do the absurdity of some of the persistent stereotypes that are held, I think, both here and in the West. Take, for instance, the belief that India has only recently woken up to globalization. Begging to differ on that, with that view, would be the Parsi entrepreneur Jamsetji Tata. He rode the roller coaster markets of the 19th century, skewed as they were to favor colonial interests, to build the corporate empire that now owns everything from Land Rover to Tetley Tea. And as I show in my book, he also came to embody something that's pretty scarce in contemporary tycoon life, a sense of deep responsibility to the workers and the society in which he prospered, and an ability to combine private interest with public purpose. Contrast that with another shrewd entrepreneur and empire builder who also appears in my book, Dhirubhai Ambani. It's an amazing story, the story of a young man who worked his way up from a Gujarati village by being, as he himself said, the bigger shark. I'll show how he built his fortune and the fortune of his sons by considering increasing inequality not as a social problem, but rather as a brilliant corporate stratagem. As for the stereotype of India as a land of mystical but not intellectual traditions, well, in Mysore, I held in my hands a manuscript inscribed on palm leaves, the work of the ruthless thinker, the ruthless political thinker, Kautilya. He was counseling the nobles of his age in the treacherous arts of what today we'd call disinformation, surveillance, and covert ops. It's a work from before the Common Era, and it makes the Renaissance's Machiavelli look sweet as a lamb. Here's just one of Kautilya's strategies for you, and I read this from his manuscript. An arrow unleashed by an archer may kill a single man or not kill anyone, but a strategy unleashed by a wise man kills even those still in the womb. There's nothing mystical about Kautilya. Rather, he saw guile and cunning and deceit as essential to maintaining power. And today, his cutthroat advice is sometimes repurposed as a guide to corporate success in a competitive global economy. Indeed, I'm told that the Pakistani army even prescribes Kautilya to their trainee officers as a way to gain insight into the devious Indian mind. But in the West, Kautilya is barely heard of. And even here, he's not much taught, which is to say that a significant strain of Indian thought, not to mention a very good read, is exiled from its rightful position, that of being an international classic of political thought, and one reminding us that the contemporary Indian balancing act between liberty, security, and prosperity has been a subject of reflection for many centuries. As I made my series of radio programs and podcasts with the BBC, I thought of them as a kind of gateway drug, meant to lead you to the deeper, more immersive, and I think in the end, I hope, more stimulating experience of the book. And the book itself, my hope is that each of the individual essays in it serves as a gateway to the next essay, so that by the end of the book, you get a more nuanced sense of the arc and texture of Indian history. That urgent need for nuance extends even to the individuals we Indians celebrate most. Take the most famous Indian reformer of modern times, Gandhi. He's often portrayed as a spiritual paragon, someone who transcends his historical moment. But in the story I tell of his surprising rise to power, I ask you to see him as he was, an individual of flaws and eccentricities in possession of some very modern strategic gifts. For one, he was a brilliant exploiter of mass media images, someone who could have taught Steve Jobs a thing or two about branding. Consider Gandhi's most famous act of nonviolent resistance, the Salt Satyagraha of 1930. He always claimed that it came to him in a flash of inspiration. But he managed the march's execution with uncanny grasp of the media as a political tool. The 79 marchers who marched with him, each one was chosen and vetted by Gandhi himself. No political colleagues were invited, lest they dilute attention that he wanted centered on him. The marchers' outfits, well, Gandhi designed them. No political insignias allowed, in order that the procession could convey a timeless quality. He alone would carry a stick, ensuring his leadership would stand out. And the finishing touch was to dispatch an advance crew to stoke up the excitement of villages, just before he and his marchers, followed by the motor brigades of camera crews, rolled in. And those camera crews from around the world, well, needless to say, Gandhi had invited them too. And so the jiggly footage of the Mahatma striding across the dusty plains, leading his band of followers, was imprinted on the imaginations of people all across the world. The tiny stick man with teapot ears showing up the imperial blimps. Some months later, Time magazine would be drawing him for its cover, a cover in which he's shown studying a newspaper, reading perhaps about his own success at managing the media across the world. Now, to see Gandhi as the shrewd strategist he was is not, of course, to diminish him. It's to reanimate him as a man and as a leader who ranks beside a small handful of contemporaries who have made the modern world. But unlike a Stalin, a Hitler, or a Mao, Gandhi won power through nonviolence, and his goals, of course, were infinitely different. And as I tell in my book, it took real guts and nerve to build a movement in a society with a scant history of large-scale collective action. But what he pulled off defined a nationalist imagination and expanded the world's repertoire of dissent and peaceful disagreement. Gandhi was hardly the most progressive of our imaginative dissenters. Consider Periyar, for instance, a regional hero of the South, who I think should be an All India one. With his wild beard, he looked like a beat poet, down to the little dog he kept beside him, the better to scare off Brahmins. An atheist and a rationalist who styled himself as the anti-Gandhi, Periyar liked to wear black to counter Gandhi's white. From the 1920s to the 1970s, Periyar waged an intellectual campaign against upper caste northerners dominating the national movement. Less known, though, is also his powerful advocacy for women's rights. For almost half a century, he pressed for women's education, independence, and even for unhindered access to contraception in blunt fighting prose. "Have cats ever freed rats?" Periyar wrote. "Have foxes ever liberated goats or chickens? Have whites ever enriched Indians? Have Brahmins ever given non-Brahmins justice? We can be confident that women will never be emancipated by men." Women, he would say again and again, had to free themselves through their own personal and political action. As I traced the rise of this no-take-no-prisoners reformer and the careers of other social disruptors whom I write about, I was reminded of a simple historical truth, of how under sustained creative critique, even a society as rigid as ours will change. Another bedrock premise of mine, that for too long, India's most compelling minds have often been forced to exist in splendid, simplified isolation, whether it's ancient figures like Panini or Ashoka, or Ram Mohan Roy, a man who corresponded with Tom Paine, conversed with Jeremy Bentham, and in his campaign against Sati, was part of the first global humanitarian movements in the early 19th century, movements which included the abolition of slavery, the rights of women, and the rights also of oppressed nations. My book tries to restore such figures to their rightful place as men and women engaged with other individuals and ideas across time and also across borders. Only that way, I think, might readers grasp that many concepts the West sees as unique to itself have parallels, resonances, and even counter-arguments in other parts of the globe. But my approach to Indian history is also critical of stereotypes that we Indians impose on historical figures, some of the most alarming of which I think relate to women. Given the deep roots of Indian patriarchy, there are far fewer historical records of significant females than there are of their male counterparts, especially when it comes to non-royals. And that absence of sources plays into an absurd cultural habit. To turn real women of intellection, fallibility, and bravery into goddess-type figures. Figures that may be worshipped by women today, but not emulated. Consider Lakshmibai, the Rani of Jhansi, who resisted British rule during the uprising of 1857. This Jezebel Rani, as the British termed her, is known to many Indians as a heroine frozen in a single dramatic image. Astride a leaping horse, sword raised high, adopted son clinging to her back. The British are about to conquer her fort, but instead of surrendering, she's making a bold midnight escape over the ramparts. As I look down from the fort walls she supposedly leapt over, only one word came to my mind: splat. But for 150 years, she's been stuck in that militant flying goddess version of history that leaves little room for the actual human being that she was, a woman struggling to rule over a kingdom that the British wanted for themselves. So it's a relief to find a more intimate sense of her from contemporary sources, only recently translated in full. She was strong of mind and body. Weightlifting, wrestling, and steeplechase were just her pre-breakfast routine. She was indifferent to regal trappings, unlike her cross-dressing husband. And so hands-on was she as a ruler that she punished criminals herself with the whack of a stick. Under pressure from the British, as I tell in my book, she anxiously decided that rebels marching from the north might help her hold on to her kingdom, a decision with tragic results on both sides. And as I narrate the moving story of a woman ruler who took on the British and was killed by them, I'm also trying to offer something about the Indian, that the Indian past is decidedly short on, not goddesses, but rather sophisticated, judgment-making female leaders, real individuals who are grappling with difficult conditions, individuals that today's young people might actually engage with. As for the polarizing 20th century leader, Indira Gandhi, initially written off as a dumb doll by her colleagues, she was soon leading a country, inspiring equal parts admiration and loathing back when Hillary Clinton was still in her teens. And what I argue in my book is that her suspension of democratic rights during the mid-1970s, during the emergency, served paradoxically to deepen democracy in the long run by provoking an active opposition and a kind of recommitment to democratic liberties and legal process. And that's, I think, something to remember as we follow the current struggles for free speech, dissent, and individual expression. Among other figures I consider are those excluded from our historical memory because they don't fall into any of the standard narrative silos of Indian history, Hindu, Muslim, or European. For instance, I tell the astounding story of a brilliantly adaptive Ethiopian teenager who converted to Islam and was shipped to India as a slave, and who rose to become a Deccan power broker. As I researched my book, I heard many young Indians extol the bravery of Shivaji, who defied the Mughals and serves today as a symbol of Hindu pride and resistance to Muslim rule. But when I mentioned Malik Amber, a fierce resister of Mughal expansion before Shivaji, eyes went blank. Ultimately freed at the death of his owner, Malik Amber and his army of crack horsemen mastered control of the treacherously hilly Deccan countryside, repeatedly stalling the southward push of the Mughal Emperor Akbar and his son Jahangir. He was such a thorn to the Mughals that the Emperor Jahangir took to commissioning gruesome miniature paintings like this one, in which he beheaded the Ethiopian, but only on paper. It's a fantasy that the Emperor failed time and time again to achieve in real life. But Jahangir might have been pleased had he foreseen the future, which did secure the elimination of Malik Amber from Indian history. Malik Amber wasn't a Hindu native defending some ancient motherland. He was an African outsider, and thereby destined to be diminished in a society that's still deeply prejudiced against dark skin color. Descendants of African slaves like him now live poor and ghettoized, many of them in Gujarat. And children growing up in these shunned communities will find no mention in their school books of a self-made power entrepreneur whose skin color and lineage they share. Occasionally in slum alleys, village lanes, as I researched, occasionally in slum alleys or village lanes, as I researched incarnations, I just want to get to that one. The one before. That doesn't matter. Occasionally, as I researched incarnations, I overheard teenagers explaining to their friends what I was up to, and it went along the lines of, "He's telling the story of how India became number one." And indeed, it's the habit of national histories to justify the present as the perfect and necessary outcome of what came before. But as I worked on my book, I was struck again and again by how many of the 50 individuals, like Malik Amber, posed pointed challenges to the Indian present. Through religious collisions and philosophical and ethical explorations, those individuals were part of intense arguments that have kept going for millennia, about what kind of life is worth living, about what kind of society is worth having, what hierarchies are morally legitimate, what role religion has in the political and legal order, what kind of love is valid, who owns the water and the land, and what kind of place India should be. A civilization that's able to produce a Buddha and a Mirabai, a Phule, a Gandhi, a Dhirubhai Ambani, that civilization is one open both to radical experiments with self-definition and to productive arguments about what a country and its people should value. And such diverse energy is worth celebrating, especially at a time when some in India want to transform this multiplicity of ideas of creative self-criticism and dissidence into a singular religious concoction. This emphatically is the moment for a deeper consideration of the Indian past and its legacies. As India becomes more and more central to discussions about the world, I see my book as a way of asking readers like you to set aside the myths and to look afresh at our extraordinary history, which promises to complicate the stories that we Indians tell about ourselves and the stories that the world tells about us. Thank you.
Thank you, Sunil, and joining us on stage, Nilanjana Roy, who will be in conversation with Sunil. Nilanjana, as you will know, is a renowned literary critic, journalist, and of course a writer as well. Over to you, Nilanjana.
Thank you so much for that, Sunil. You know, when the BBC radio series started and we were looking at this idea of the project of covering India in 50 lives, a lot of us wondered how it might be done, what you would end up leaving out, whether it would actually go beyond just being short biographies. And I think what happened for us is as the radio series happened and as the book after that came up, I was surprised to find that my idea of India was being substantially reworked. I think there's something inherently subversive in the idea of putting forward biographies, and not just in time, but in general, you know, reminding people that the past is about people who were real and who existed. Once you do that, what you start to do is you step away from the idea that people might be able to claim them for one reason or the other. And I was wondering whether you would start by just talking about biography as an approach to history. And is there a reason why established schools of thought or people who want to claim India's history one way or the other step away from really getting to know the men and women behind all of this?
I think there's something exactly right in what you just said, which is that, you know, lives are much, if you really look at the intricacy of lives as they're actually lived, they're much harder to claim. They're much harder to be given a simple caption. So in that sense, if you do actually start to explore the lived complexity of a life at its time in history, you start to see the variety of motivations, just as in our own lives. It would be very hard to give a caption to our life as we live them. They run in different directions, different motivations, and I think that's what one sees with many of these figures. But what happens, and this is what I mean by the attempt to demythologize in order to rehumanize, what happens, of course, is they do get simplified and reduced to becoming a symbol. Or indeed, in many cases, a caricature to carry an ideological story or to be on a banner, to be waved for a particular cause. And so, you know, one of the things I did want to do, and in that sense, I didn't think of it necessarily as subversive, but perhaps it does have something of that effect. But one of the things I did want to do was to reclaim some of these what had become essentially symbols, the names of roads, the statues we see, the statues we don't see because they're so familiar, the names of roads we don't notice because they're so familiar, to reclaim those for ourselves so that we could see the past not as a foreign country, but as the past as being our country, inhabited by people like ourselves in some ways. And the other thing, I guess the other reason for trying to use biographical stories was that it, for me, offers a thread in threads into the past. It's a much easier and I think more attractive way of entering into the past and also beginning to explore sometimes really quite complicated ideas, quite complicated arguments through the story of a life rather than through a kind of abstract statement of a position or a kind of history that is more structural or statistical or so forth.
When I look at the lives out here, they include the lives of people like Periyar and Kabir, Mirabai, Birsa Munda, Basava. And I wonder, you know, were you aware right from the start that you were going to be so strongly attracted to the dissenters? Was there a natural affinity for them, or was there something that you were looking for? And the second question related to this is, do you think you could argue that India, long before we actually became a country and a functional democracy, but do you think there was a strong tradition of dissent running through the subcontinent? Do you think you could make that claim?
On the first question, I mean, no, I didn't think that I was, you know, drawing up a list of dissenters, as you call them. One of the criteria, and there are several of why I chose the list I did, but one was they had to interest me. And for some reason, I found myself being drawn to these characters, not necessarily knowing that they might lead to a kind of sequence of dissenting positions. But I think as I worked on them and read about them and went to some of the places where they lived, that did start to emerge. The fact that these were figures who were engaging very powerfully with the social circumstances that they were living in, whether it was the patriarchal order in the case of Mirabai, whether it was the caste system, whether it was certain kinds of religious conformities. So they were individuals who were struggling against a particular structure. And I mean, I think there is a way in which some of the most remarkable figures in our history are voices of individual expression and the affirmation of individual values in coming out of very confined and constrained circumstances. So these, whether it's the colonial period, when so many of these figures of the 20th century are trying to find their own freedom, or whether it's earlier, these are figures who had to kick against what they were surrounded by. And in that sense, I mean, you know, one of the things that struck me, and this goes back to the earlier point about how we view these lives, that very often figures, many of the figures I write about, are described or presented to us as rather staid, venerable, indeed even kind of pious statesman figures. Actually, if you look at their lives, these were angry young women and men, you know, who were kicking against what they saw around them, whether it's the Buddha, whether it's Mahavir, whether it's Guru Nanak, whether it's Kabir, Phule, you know, Ambedkar, Periyar. These were really rebellious figures, and I think we tend to smooth that over or lose that edge when we turn them into these venerable characters.
I think I was also very pleasantly surprised at how moved I was often to read about the life of somebody whom I thought I might know, you know, whether it was Gandhi or whether it was Ambedkar, and to find something that I hadn't actually looked at before and to say, oh, that person was human, was not just a figure out of a school textbook. I wanted to ask you about the 2 years in which you were traveling around the country, because you went to places that were, some of them were, fairly accessible, the Jiva Institute in Faridabad, Mysore, libraries, all of that. Some of them, like Chalkhad or Sanathi, were definitely unusual. And aside from talking to experts, you also came into conversation with the people who lived there, you know, and who had a sense or didn't have a sense of the histories of the people you were talking about. And I was wondering, did this two-year process, at the end of it, did you find that your sense of the country had also radically changed or deepened in any way? Are there people you remember, particularly people whom you met?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think actually being in these places, in the landscapes, in the monuments and the buildings in the neighborhoods where some of these lives were lived does make a huge impression. And indeed, also talking to people and as you say, seeing the extent to which a figure still matters to people, or the extent to which they're forgotten sometimes. And I hope that, you know, that sense of being in these places does kind of emerge in the writing. And I think it did shape the writing of the book. And I did, it was a lot of travel. I mean, literally from, you know, Tuticorin to Shantiniketan to Sringeri to Jhansi to Dandi to Benares and so forth. And, you know, to give you an example of how I think this did make a deep impression. I mean, take a figure like Kabir, who is this extraordinarily raw voice that still reaches to us across 500 years in this very direct way. And when you visit the community that he broadly came from, which are the Ansari weavers in Benares, and who now live in one of the poorest neighborhoods in the city. It's a low-lying neighborhood that floods easily. And you actually, you know, you see the circumstances in which they're trying to make a living, where, in a sense, their living today is being undermined by things like WhatsApp and so on. You see how, you know, the voice of someone like Kabir, what's pushing that, what's impelling it, and also how strong he must have felt he had to make that voice in order to be able to reach anyone who could hear it. Because in a sense, he was so far down the social order. You really had to find an extra energy and vigor in that. So I think seeing these places and did make a deep impression on me, and certainly has changed how I see these figures historically.
I was coming to that. I understand that selecting the 50 lives must have been almost heartbreaking in some ways, in the sense of people you left out. A lot of people were surprised, for example, that you left out Nehru. And I started to understand why you hadn't been able to include more women when I read that bit about searching for women's histories and finding an absence, you know, of records, an absence. There's a very moving part, for example, where a historian talks about the Rani of Jhansi and says that she wishes that she could find the box with the Rani's papers, you know, because her voice is missing from the many things said about her. But in the selection, I'm sure that there were some people whom you started off knowing that you wanted to write about. Something about the omissions and also the discoveries, the people who surprised you, whom you didn't ever think that you might actually be writing about.
Yeah, well, it's interesting. I mean, yes, I did have a much longer list to begin with. But, you know, once I got it down to the 50 who are there, I kind of didn't miss the ones I'd forgotten. It wasn't like I was missing a finger or a limb or something. They kind of, you know, fell by the wayside. But I, you know, the ones that I did choose, I chose because I wanted, through them, to be able to tell this larger story of 2,500 years, but also to have figures who would allow me to explore some of the central tensions as I saw them in Indian history, whether it was to do with religion or gender or caste or region or individuality, indeed. So the figures to come back also to this I think very important question of how women appear in the book, and the actual number of essays focused on women is 6 in the book, and I hope that everyone feels the outrage that I feel that it should be so few. But as you say, the reason for that is, as I found it, because I wanted to use actual documents, primary sources. And when you go back beyond 200 years, there's actually very little, particularly on non-royal figures, people who are not queens or empresses and so on. There are bits of poetry, there are fragments here and there, but actually not very much to reconstruct the life. And that's what I call, in the essay you referred to, the lost treasure of Indian history, the voices of its women. I hope that this will be something that prompts more work on that. But having said that, I didn't at any point feel that I could only address the issues that are important to women's rights and so on, only in the essays on women.
It seemed to me that that's a deep mistake to think about it in that way, somehow to ghettoize the issue to only talking about it in the essays on women. So in fact, running through the book is the question about gender and the position of women. So whether it's the Buddha or Mahavir or Basava or Guru Nanak or Phule or Roy or Periyar or Tagore, all of these are concerned, I think, quite centrally with issues that, about women's positions and their rights. So that was a way in which I had to address that. The surprises, again, going back to what you said about discovering new things about familiar figures. For me, some of the hardest to write about in the book were those figures that were very familiar, and we had lots of information, and those figures on which we had virtually no information. And in a sense, the two extremes for me there were Panini, for whom we know virtually nothing. 5th century BC, we have the Ashtadhyayi, but we have very little else. So in a sense, one had to kind of reconstruct as well as one could what he was trying to do. And the opposite extreme, of course, was Gandhi. We have 100 volumes just of his own writings, let alone of how many biographies there are about him. And those were really challenging to do. And because they led me to discover new things or to think newly about them.
It's almost like a rescue mission. You know, you're either rescuing a historical figure from the weight of symbolism that's been placed on him or trying to dig somebody out from a past that's been almost lost. We will come to audience questions in a very short while. But I had a question about, you wrote a beautiful essay in 97. This was from the revised introduction to The Idea of India, where you were talking about India's future depending on the country resisting what you call certain powerful seductions. And among these, you said, you know, the temptation of a clear definition of nationalism and the apparent neatness of authoritarian politics, both of which are very much, you know, part of the discussion today. They're in the air, not just from particular political parties, but they seem to have become part of the national conversation. And I was struck by the words you used out here, you know, the powerful seductions, the temptation of something that appears to be very clear. Either you are a patriot or you're not. And as you said, you know, the neatness, the tidiness of authoritarian politics, it puts people into certain boxes and it gives them a sense of identity. But when you look at this broad, sprawling history that you've hinted at through these 50 lives, can I ask, you know, do we need to really, really start looking at the past all over again? I mean, what do we need to do in order to get to this point?
Well, you know, I think that one of the things that I hope becomes apparent through this account is that that past, as it was lived, thought, acted, really can't be held or contained within any simple ideological story or any simple political party line or any simple even nationalist story. I mean, this is a far more rebellious, cantankerous past than I think can be lined up in any sort of neatly regimented way. I mean, if you look at it, it's just a bunch of rabble-rousers, really. And I think that's the sense that we need to see them in. And so the idea that somehow that could be streamlined or made to belong to a single story seems to me, you know, it's impossible once you actually look at it. It's not even that one is making an argument against it. You simply have to show what the past is like to see how difficult it is or impossible it is to try and narrow it into a simple story. So I think, you know, the thing that strikes me is that the attempt to turn it into a simple story is actually in a curious way still really wedded to an old European conception of nationalism, which is, if you like, the 19th century European view of nationalism as defined by a single culture or a single religion or a single language or a single people. And that's an amazingly provincial and parochial definition of nationalism. It's an incredibly colonial definition of nationalism. And somehow that's come to seem to some people as a distinctive definition of what Indian nationalism should be. Whereas what I think
is the distinctive you, which was an attempt in the mid-20th century to be somehow true to this rebellious, multi-stranded past, that actually is to me a much more distinctive definition of what India is. And that is the one, I think, that needs to be defended in order to be true to our own history. Not for no other reason than that, it seems to me. But yes, I think there are you know this temptation, this seduction for simplicity, for something that can be given a neat caption. But that way, I mean, if you look at those countries, those nations that have chosen simplicity, somehow or the other, true complexity comes back to hit them in the face. And I think it's much better to recognize that right from the beginning rather than paper over it.
Okay. And again, you know, one of the things that you said in your talk and that you said in the book so well is you said that you were moved by how many of these lives pose a challenge to the Indian present. And you see, you know, they remind us of future possibilities that are in danger of being closed off. In a interview that you gave to the BBC today, you spoke of a challenge to India's diversity. But you've also spent the last 2 years meeting people who are much younger, who perhaps have a different way of looking at things. Do you want to talk a little bit about the possibilities that you see, the ones that are in danger of being closed off, but also the ones that might start to open up now from unexpected directions?
I think, you know, this book is about trying to sketch out some of those possibilities. There's possibilities that lie in the past, but are, I think, still very alive and valuable for us today and very animating. And actually, what I, indeed speaking to younger people as well as I was working on this, is that there is a real engagement with and an interest in the past. I mean, this idea that somehow that there's a lack of interest or it's simply eyes on the future, I think is not actually true. Because after all, if you think about it, people are looking, we all look for kind of models. We all look for exemplars. We all look for something in the most difficult circumstances to keep us going. Some kind of story, some kind of inspiration that we carry in somewhere in our innermost minds that keep us going. And I think that's one of the things that the past can often provide. So for me, thinking about that is not an indulgence or a luxury. It's actually a way of providing a kind of imaginative resource from which we can think about the future. And I think also that there's a way in which, you know, that history, that past, is critical for us as a democracy. Because what takes us ahead isn't some belief in a theological providential design. It isn't some belief in some ideological, paradise that we're headed to, as a communist country might believe, or as a religiously governed country might believe. All that there is, in a sense, are the lessons of the past to from which to figure out what to do next. So for us as a kind of young democracy thinking about what to do next, it seems to me looking at the past, figuring out why we did certain things well and why we do certain things so badly, is the only thing we have to figure out what to do next.
I was wondering whether you'd like to read a section. You'd mentioned that there was something that you wanted to read from the book. And I loved one of the quotes that you used in the section on Khusro, you know, where he spoke about India as it was at that point. And he said, if a Khurasani, a Greek, or an Arab comes here, he will not face any problems, for the people will treat him kindly. You know, and I would like to believe that we can still find a way back there.
Yes, I hope so too. Okay, well, thank you. So I'll read the opening and the ending of one of the essays in the book. It shouldn't take more than a few minutes. But imagine an imperial court in South India at the beginning of the 16th century. The king sits at the center, flanked by women with eyes like blue sapphires, who were cooling the air with yak-tail fans. Seated in front of him, scholars discussed the fine points of Paninian grammar, atomistic philosophy, and metaphysics. Warriors hold swords darkly glowing in the afternoon light, which filters across the hall, refracting through jeweled crowns of defeated rivals as it comes to rest on the king himself. This king ruled over the largest empire in South India, and the description of his court comes from his favorite poet, the great Telugu writer Alasani Pedana. The king's capital, built at Hampi in the central Deccan, was called Vijayanagar, the city of victory. His name was Krishnadevaraya, and he had a talent for turning conflict into order. Like quite a few triumphant Hindu kings of the pre-colonial era, he often gets recruited into Indian history's platoon of resistors to Muslim domination. In his case, against the sultanates of the Deccan, whose borders edged the Vijayanagar Empire. But Krishnadevaraya was a successful warrior ruling in a brutal age, a fact that lent itself to an unsentimental, tactical, and highly flexible approach to politics, reminiscent of Kautilya's. Krishnadevaraya was also living at a moment when the literary imagination of South India was being revolutionized. And for Krishnadevaraya, this meant that in addition to conquering and ruling, he embraced poetry, a form in which he could consider himself not just a monarch, but as a human being too. And I'll jump to the end of the essay. Krishnadevaraya molded the language into his long poem, the Amuktamulyada, the woman who gives a garland already worn, about kingship and the worldly pleasure that goes with it, but also about the renunciatory urges and self-doubts of its author. The Amuktamulyada is full of hard-boiled advice about how to raise money to fight wars, how to control ambitious Brahmins, and how to put down rebellious forest and hill folk. But then the Amuktamulyada starts to get much more interesting as it moves away from the usual kingly self-presentation, the customary display of wisdom, cunning, and ruthlessness. We begin to hear doubts and questionings, the stirrings of a subjective voice. In the Amuktamulyada, Krishnadevaraya dramatizes debates about the nature of kingship, about who is the best king, about whether it is better to rule or to renounce. He's having a debate with himself. He's turning around in his mind the contradictions and ambivalences of royal life, the inner conflict of tradition. And I'll just end with a verse of his. The king is non-violent, though he kills. Chaste, though he has women. Truthful, though he lies. Ever fasting, though he eats well. A hero, though he uses trickery. Rich, though he gives away. Kingship is rather strange.
Thank you so much. You know, I think I love this book so much, not just because it's important and it speaks to the present moment, but because it was so completely enjoyable to read. It was filled with surprises. We have time for questions from the audience. I see hands up that side. Do we have mics for people, or do you need a mic? We'll start from that side then. You had your hands up?
Quick question. Nehru is a significant omission, and if you care to tell us what's happening to that lovely book you're planning on Nehru, which has been in the making for a while, as I hear.
It sounds like you
much
know more
look forward to.
It sounds like you know more about it than I do. look, I mean, this was a in large part it was also this was a book of kind of self-education. I wanted to find out about and write about things that I knew less about. And, you know, Nehru I've written a bit about. I've said things and talked about him here and there. So in a sense, it wasn't that interesting for me to try and write about him here. And, you know, what and if I do something next, I perhaps I should come and talk to you afterwards for some advice.
The lady in red.
Congratulations, sir, for such a wonderful project. Sir, as you have said that there are certain omissions, are there any omissions that you really wanted to them to be part of this book, but due to lack of any material or documentation, you have to omit them? Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I mean, as I said, you know, one would have liked to have been able to write more about women, and particularly non-royal women, and there was a lack of documentation for that. But, you know, I don't see this, I mean, I see this book as an invitation to all of us to bring in those other figures who are not there. And so this is not this isn't called the makers of modern India or the builders of modern India. It's just 50 lives. It's 50 lives that are out there. And I think we should continue to add to those. We should continue to repeople and repopulate the past. And I hope that, you know, it'll be possible, whether it's a website or whatever, where we can have a list where people can put their own names that they wanted to add there and the rationale for why they think they should be there. So, you know, I'm less concerned about those names that are not here, because I'm sure that we'll find other ways to know about them and speak about them.
I want to know how were you motivated and what were your consideration in selecting only these 50 people? You mentioned about Raja Ram Mohan Roy, Swami Vivekananda and Tagore in West Bengal, but I wonder whether you have included Sarat Chandra and Bankim Chatterjee, who shaped the course of events in those times, and they molded the society, and their imprint is there for all to see. Now, my related question is, since many people have been left out, are you planning to write a sequel to this, including other characters which you haven't been able to put in?
Between this and the Nehru book, you're going to be a very busy man.
No, but I think Penguin should sign you up to do the sequel. No, look, I mean, every conversation I have about this book, I'm buttonholed and said, you know, what about so-and-so? And so I've been keeping a kind of little notebook where I jot these down. And sure, I mean, the list can go on and on and on. But as I say, this is an opening of the door, not a closing of the door. This isn't a kind of Noah's Ark where I put these 50 on board and was kind of sailing off into the future and the rest get left behind. It's an invitation to continue to add these figures. And the names you mentioned are all absolutely important.
Good evening, sir. Hello. Yeah. So as you have been talking about women and the participation of women in Indian history, so what, according to you, would be possible reasons for very less women or very less significant women in the making of history?
Well, I wouldn't say less women in the making of history. I think that, you know, very much there in the making of history. What I would say is less evidence of their making of the history, less sources in a sense, less written, less archaeological, less other kinds of sources that we can draw on. And, you know, I think the primary reason for that is not a difficult one to identify, which is this very strong patriarchal society and order that has existed. So even when we look at a figure like Mirabai, who for me is, I mean, you know, you can go back and you can find, for example, in the Theragatha, you can find the voices of Buddhist women. But again, quite hard to individuate them in some ways as lives whose stories you can tell. But you know, the first really strong voice that comes through is, I would say, and one can argue about this, but I would say is Mirabai. But even there, you know, it's fragmentary. We know the songs, we know some that attribute to her, and you have to really dig around and reconstruct as best as you can. But I think that's the reason that, and you know, look, if you look at what she was reacting to and against, is this very strong Rajput patriarchal society. And I think that you see again and again and again, which is really at the root of the issue you're raising.
This is a question relating to the historiographical principles which underpin your initiative. It seemed to me that you're looking at an archive which is marked by erasure, and as you point out, forms of fragmentation, and even sometimes forms of selective amnesia. In that context, it's a significant initiative to recuperate, as it were, lost stories, and especially taking into account the individuality of the subjects you're looking at. But it seems to me that there may be a sort of risk as well, which I'm sure you're aware of, insofar as the question of emplotment is concerned. How much of your own subjective imagination sort of begins to leaven, as it were, your narrative or excavation of past figures and their lives, their life stories. We're aware that during the phase of nationalism, I'll just end with this quick reference, many of those figures actually began to write autobiographies. So autobiography became a way for them to actually begin to implot their story into the story, if you were, of the nascent nation. Did you consult some of those sources, and what would be your view of the importance of autobiography or life writing with reference to your own initiative as a biographer, as it were, of the country?
Sure. No, I certainly consulted those, and autobiographies can, if read with sufficient skepticism, often be very interesting and useful tools. I mean, this question that you talk about the sort of implotment, yes, of course, you know, one gives a shape to a life which perhaps, as it's actually lived, didn't necessarily have that shape. It's a retrospective shape that we see to a life. But that's something that I think inevitably biography does. And in that sense, you know, biography is not the enactment of a life. It's a kind of retrospective interpretation of a life on the basis of facts. But it's also interesting that many of the figures that I do talk about had at the back of their own minds models of previous people in Indian history. So, you know, I talk about how, for example, for many of the religious figures, there's this theme, this thematic of renunciation, this giving up of some worldly goods. And it's very interesting how that is a kind of recurring theme in the plots which people live their lives through, that turning away from something. So there's a way also in which people, through their understanding of the past, try to implot their own lives as they live them.
There's a question from the back, but just before that,
yes.
Could we just see a show of hands, because we only have time for two more questions. Okay, after this, we'll take one question from there, and the lady in brown.
Yes, Mr. Kalani, all the figures, the Bengali figures in the book are...
Which figures?
The figures who are Bengali, mm-hmm. or from Bengal, they are some way connected to the Renaissance, or they are part of the Renaissance. Yet, in the book, you use the word only once, and that too within inverted commas. My question to you is that this Bengal Renaissance, is it only a construct amongst the Bengali intellectuals?
Fighting words.
Well, you're probably better placed to answer that. I mean, throughout the book, I wanted to avoid some of the kind of set categories that we use for thinking about some of these eras and some of the kind of easy analogies that are often made. And Renaissance is obviously a term that's widely used, which makes an analogy with a particular moment. And you know, I was more interested in other things rather than whether we can describe what happened in Bengal from the late 18th century to the early 20th or late 19th as a Bengali Renaissance. That didn't particularly interest me. I think it was a very, very interesting moment in political, cultural, intellectual history. But I don't see the real function of the term Renaissance. It doesn't illuminate anything for me, which is why I didn't use it.
My question has to do with your discussion on nationalism. I'm here. I think, you know, you mentioned that your book has a lot of sort of like divisive characters, people who express assent and dissent in different ways. But all of them in your book and all of us sitting here subscribe to something that we know is Indian. So given that today there is very little agreement on what it means to be Indian for a lot of different people, what do you personally think connects all those people in your book and connects us? Because as far as I see it, for example, my life as a student, your life as a historian, and a lot of our lives, you know, ranging from being workers right up to being the top academics in this country, we all have very different interpretations of what it means to be Indian. So if you could clarify what you think, looking across all these characters that are in your book, is common to them and gives them an Indian identity, I'd be much obliged.
Well, you know, at the risk of sounding perhaps oversimple, I would say that it's precisely that capacity
to recognize that we all have different ideas of what it is to be Indian. It's precisely being willing, and I think that is what is distinctive, actually. It's being able to live in an open society where we are willing to say that no one has a privileged definition of what it is to be Indian. It is something that is open for discussion and negotiation and revision and remaking through people engaging in that conversation. And I think, you know, what the figures are, I mean, I think they very much represent that, a desire and a capacity and a recognition of the importance of saying what they're saying while being able to recognize other people also saying what they're saying. So in a sense, precisely for me, it's the strength of a definition of being Indian to be able to say there is no single definition of being Indian. And for me, that actually is what the meaning of the idea of India is, that it allows the endless conversation about that.
Thank you so much.
This actually, I guess, proceeds from that question. As you were researching the 50 lives, were there any surprises? Were there any disappointments? Were there any changes you needed to make in the perception that you began with? Were there difficulties in changing those perceptions? How did you deal with all of that across 50 lives?
Probably need to talk to my psychoanalyst about the latter bits of those, or higher one, to help me through. But yes, no, there were changes in how I saw some of these figures, and complete discoveries. So, you know, Basava, 12th century Kannada poet. I mean, really, you know, seeing just what an extraordinary word maker he was, as he described himself, a maker of utterances. Complete revelation. Actually, also, you know, writing about someone like Guru Nanak, who one thinks of as this very pious, staid figure, and actually seeing what an extraordinarily eccentric and interesting figure he was. So the story of Chidambaram Pillai, you know, forgotten in the kind of nationalist stories we tell ourselves, but some of these forgotten lost stories of failure. I mean, his story was the story of a man who goes to jail, who's imprisoned by the British for sedition after this extraordinary venture of trying to start a steamship company to rival the British. And, you know, we think of the freedom struggle and jail in the freedom struggle as being this great schooling ground of moral virtue. You go to jail and you come out as a great leader and a hero, and whether it's Gandhi or in other parts of the world, Mandela or Martin Luther King and so on. But, you know, for most people, you go to jail and you come out as a broken person, or you end up as a broken person. And that was the case with Pillai. So I think some of these stories that we have forgotten, for me, were also real discoveries. And all the more important, I felt the importance of wanting to tell them to all of you, to a kind of wider public.
Okay, thank you so much. I think we're out of time. But, you know, thank you for exercising the simple freedom to take your curiosity where it led you. I mean, this book, in that sense, claims a certain kind of azadi that's quite precious. Thank you.
Thank you.